All right, I think you're gonna like our next guest. Joining us is Richard Ojeda. He's retired US Army, only 16 medals, other awards and badges on top. Former West Virginia State Senator, former favorite congressional candidate, national spokesperson for No Dem Left Behind, and now new contributor to TYT Rebel headquarters. Here comes Ojeda.
How you doing? Hey, what's up, my brother?
I'm airborne, man. I'm good.
That's what I'm talking about.
All right. So, obviously, you've got a long career in the military. We're withdrawing from Afghanistan. Curious about your thoughts. There's on TV, you're getting two things. One is botched exit. The other is we should have stayed. We should have stayed. Curious your take on both.
Well, first and foremost, you know, I commend President Biden for taking the step to end a forever war that has done nothing but flood money into the pockets of Raytheon, Boeing, Lockheed Martin, Halliburton, and Brown and Root. I don't think there was ever going to be an easy way to get out of Afghanistan. And you know, everybody wants to sit and scream about pulling out, but the truth is we could have never known that 300,000 Afghan troops and over 100,000 Afghan police officers that we trained and equipped would literally lay down without a fight. You know, we thought, you know, with the Taliban numbering around 80,000, we thought that the force that we created would be sufficient to absolutely deal with the Taliban. And obviously, nobody knew that, you know, the president of Afghanistan would load vehicles and helicopters up with cash and leave like a thief in the night. You know, that's the type of situation that you have in Afghanistan. And it's devastating. But at the end of the day, you know, I think that over the past few years, we've made some mistakes concerning applications with visas. You know, I have an interpreter that stood by my side in combat, and his wife and 2-year-old baby are in Kabul right now, and they can't even get nowhere near the airport. It's packed. You know, they're probably going to be left behind. I've got an interpreter that is trying to get to the airport because he has a seat on a plane, but he can't get nowhere near the airport. And I fear that these people are going to be left behind, and you know, their families are going to be left behind. It breaks my heart to see this. It breaks my heart to know that we lost soldiers over there. And how do you look at their families and say, you know, we got nothing out of it? But at the end of the day, we knew that the Republicans and Fox News are going to be critical of Joe Biden making this decision. You know, they were critical over Osama bin Laden. No, excuse me, I'm sorry. They were critical over, I'm sorry, President Obama, when President Obama basically, you know, freed 5 Taliban fighters for the 1 American prisoner. You know, they want to scream and say that he did the wrong thing there, but yet nobody is speaking up about 2018 when Donald Trump released the co-founder of the Taliban, who is now getting ready to be the president of Afghanistan, and 5,000 Taliban fighters that we got nothing for. So the double standard is really sickening that we see. But at the end of the day, we've made mistakes. I kind of wish we would have said, we're leaving on this day, and for the next 6 months, we're going to be doing everything in our power to evacuate interpreters and their families, working with other countries to be able to open up their borders so that we can also let them take refugees. I wish we would have did that, but once again, we had no clue that it was going to be like this, and we were going to find ourselves with no time. We thought that 300,000 soldiers and 150,000 police officers were going to be able to secure things while we pulled out properly.
So, Richard, remind me, how many tours did you do in Afghanistan?
I just did 1 year in Afghanistan. I got 3 OIF, which 2 of them were combat, and then 1 in Afghanistan.
And so, you mentioned your interpreter. So, do you stay in touch with those guys, and how do you guys stay in touch? And do most folks who went to go serve there stay in touch with the folks that are in country now that are Afghan citizens?
Yeah, I mean, you know, Facebook. I mean, they use Facebook. I get phone calls from them. You know, I've got interpreters. I've been fortunate. You know, I've worked very hard for 11 years. I cannot tell you how many letters that I've written. In the last 2 weeks, I've probably written 30 letters to people all over the world trying to find access for these interpreters and their families. You know, five of my interpreters are right now in America, and all five of them are doing phenomenal. One graduated from Ohio State and is an electrical engineer. One of them has just purchased his second tractor trailer and does long haul trucking and is now providing an American with a job driving that second truck. I mean, you know, they're all doing phenomenal. And I'm gonna tell you, I'm gonna throw this out here. For 4 years, my interpreter in Afghanistan, I mean, who is now in Arizona, we've been writing letters to try to get his wife and his baby to America. And they have been denied every time in the past 4 years. Who denies a wife and a child for somebody who stood by our side in combat? You know, I don't know, you know, if Stephen Miller was a part of this, but somebody made this process to be almost impossible to help these people. And that's what's taken place. And it's absolutely brutal, because you know what? Even when I'm speaking to these interpreters that are in America, you know, they're happy that they're here. But their parents, their wives, some of their children are still over there. And right now, there's a big possibility that they're not gonna make it.
So Richard, sometimes neoconservatives use you guys as props in a sense, because they say, oh, you're gonna waste their efforts over there, and they lost good men, good colleagues fighting this war. And if we leave and the Taliban take over, you're saying it was for nothing. And so it's an insult to the troops. How do you respond to that?
Now that angers me. You know, I'm gonna tell you right now, if we were gonna pull out of Afghanistan, we should have did it in May of 2011 when we killed Osama bin Laden. You know, I had just landed in Bagram. I had just been home 15 days because you get the R&R when you're in combat. I landed in Bagram and was waiting for a helicopter to take me to my combat outpost. And a guy walked up to me and he says, did you hear? We got him last night. And I said, who? He said, Osama bin Laden. And the first thing I said is, well, when are we going home? But we didn't. We stayed for another 10 years. And the reason why is because of this, because of money. You know, at the end of the day, we could stay in Afghanistan for another 5 years, spend another $1 trillion, lose another 2,000 soldiers, and send another million people home, missing arms and legs and struggling with PTSD. You know, I'm angered because I know that the taxpayers of the United States of America are paying for my needs at the Veterans Administration Hospital. And you know what? They shouldn't have to pay for that. Raytheon, Lockheed Martin, let those people pay for our care, because we were over there for them. And that's what it really was. We were over there for them.
That's some serious truth right there. That's exactly right, unfortunately. Now I wanna ask you about the Afghan military though. So you know, it's easy for me to sit in a studio and say I never believed in them, but you know, you dealt with them. So a lot of folks, bad folks and good folks, thought that they would hold up, and they didn't. So what's your take? Why did they collapse immediately?
First off, corruption. The corruption is unlike anything you've ever seen. You know, I can remember when I needed to equip 8 police stations with vehicles, and I ordered 146 Toyota Hilux pickup trucks, and I got 40. And I made a call back because I know that they loaded up 146 Toyota Hilux pickup trucks for me, and 40 showed up. When I called and I said, hey, I'm missing over 100 Toyota Hilux pickup trucks, the only thing the voice on the other end of the phone said is, just reorder more. That was it. No argument, no anger, no investigation launched. You know, it was the corruption. That was a big problem. You know, you would take over, you would give these people weapons and come back 2 weeks later and half of them would be gone. And once again, just reorder. That was garbage. You know, another issue is education. Education in Afghanistan, usually when you go into a village, the teacher of all the kids in the village is the smartest kid. It's not an adult in there teaching these people for the most part. You know, the first police chief that I dealt with had a third grade education and was as corrupt as you could even begin to imagine. You know, corruption is a big problem. Education is a big problem. It's hard to teach people that don't have education and they don't understand your language very well to even teach them how to march in line. You know, I mean, you know, God bless the ones that really, really cared for their country and risked their lives every day. But it was really hard to deal with these people when they don't have that education. And when you know, the Taliban infiltrates them. You know, I can remember I had an interpreter who was 12 years old. His name was Naweeb. He's in New Zealand right now. And I can remember I was in a place called Dahani, Saigon. And I'm talking to the police chief, and surrounding me are all these police officers. And about halfway through the conversation, Naweeb completely froze up and wouldn't talk. And I noticed something was wrong. So I ended the conversation, put Naweeb in the truck, and I drove about a mile down the road and stopped. And then I looked at him and I said, Naweeb, what happened? Because when I'm talking to somebody, I expect my interpreter to do their job. Naweeb told me that the police officers were telling him, when we catch you away from the American, we're going to cut your lips off. This is a 12-year-old boy. You know, between the Taliban infiltrating the police and the military, between the lack of education and between the corruption, good Lord, it is just absolutely brutal. All right. And we tried. We tried.
Yeah, so Richard, one last thing. So first of all, let me just acknowledge, so many of our weapons are gone to the Taliban now. We wound up arming the Taliban instead of the Afghan military. And so is our money gone? It's a, although again, the defense contractors got rich off that. And now some of the worst folks on earth have high weaponry because of us. But anyways, I did want to ask you one last thing, which is local support for the Taliban. I know it's hard for you to gauge it and you've got the interpreters, etc. But I'm curious what your take was. It seems like the military partly collapsed because they don't have local support and they never really were gonna fight. And the Taliban do have local support. But again, from the outside, it's really hard to tell. So what was your sense of it?
You know, that's one of the reasons why when I was in Afghanistan, I mean, I was different. I wasn't like most people. I didn't have a company. I didn't have a platoon. I didn't have a squad. I would go out and literally be 100 miles away from the nearest American with me, my sergeant first class. I had an E6 that was a mechanic and our interpreter. And we would be out there. We could never call a police station and say, hey, we're coming tomorrow. Because we could not trust anybody in that police station to not sell us out to the Taliban. You know, we operated everywhere and we literally, I mean, we were almost captured in a place called Espeshta. We were literally 5 minutes away from 60 Taliban fighters snatching us up. And you know, I like to think that we would have fought to the death. But I mean, we literally were almost captured. It's just so hard over there because you really, it's hard to know who to trust. It's hard to even be able to paint a picture for people.
Yeah. All right. We got to run, but I want to talk to you more about this. And everybody, check out Richard's videos on Rebel HQ because I mean, he obviously knows exactly what happened over there from his perspective and the perspective of so many other American service members that were there. So Richard, thank you for joining us. Appreciate it.
Brother, anytime, Jink. I'll see you in California next month.
Thanks for watching The Young Turks. Really appreciate it. Another way to show support is through YouTube memberships. You'll get to interact with us more. There's live chat, emojis, badges. You've got emojis of me, Anna, John, JR. So those are super fun. But you also get playback of our exclusive member only shows and specials right after they air. So all of that, all you gotta do is click that join button right underneath the video. Thank you.